Welcome to the checkpoints. In our second segment, we have been looking at the Karamoja region with Honorable Lochap, who is talking to us about the region, about this kind of iron sheets that has been going on in the media, but also talking to us how government could help them as a region to cope and be at par with the rest of the country. So, Honorable, you have been elaborating to us the challenges of the region. Tell us more about what else your people are facing and how they are living down there in your region of Karamoja.
Yes, thank you very much, Vivian. The people of Karamoja need to be attended to. One, when the side of economic activities, there is almost nothing taking place in the area. For one reason, is that these are people who only would depend on the cow and on agriculture. When agriculture fails, definitely they have to depend on the cow.
So what you are telling us, Honorable, like you said before we went for the break, is that the practices of cattle rustling, the movements from one area to another have all stopped.
Yes, real cattle rustling has stopped. What is there now is theft. And the cattle rustling, the cattle theft has been commercialized. Once your animals are raided today, by night they have been loaded in vehicles and taken away.
To where?
To unknown destination. The thieves know whom to sell, and then the one who buys knows where to take. So that's one of the issues. And that has affected already the region, because even the number of cows which had increased has reduced because of this commercialization.
Those thieves, Honorable, are they people from the community? Are they people who come from other regions?
We have thieves within the community. Then we have also thieves outside the NI. Outside the community, who connive with these people, and whenever they steal the animals, they know where to sell and who to pick their name. Then under this scientific way of handling issues now, the phone business, just send and they send you money, your money in mobile phone. So that is it now. So it is no longer a raid where you raid and go and keep. For prestige, it is now you raid and sell.
Okay. So the challenge of the cattle thieving.
And we would have managed this if we had. So if actually those who are in roadblocks were very tough and they are able to sustain it. If those who are in the authority of investigation and intelligence were able to do their work, because everybody has left. It is a work, and they are now doing business.
Do you think that those people at roadblocks whom you're talking about, and those should be security operatives, do you think they connive with the thieves to
probably
aid this
cattle? Probably. That's why the cars thieving. Pass. Mm. The vehicles pass through roadblocks. They pass through our roads. They don't fly in the air, but they go through the road. And that's why our animals go pass.
Okay, Officer, Honorable, now off to insecurity, because you can see there is an element of insecurity there.
Yeah.
Where are the guns coming from in that region?
So the guns
that the people have.
The guns, I remember in the other disarmament, which I participated when I was a district chairperson and when I was a resident district commissioner. I remember the army, the security intelligence, everybody was concerned, and we removed the guns, and there were no guns in Karamoja. But as of now, because Karamoja is porous, we have porous borders, and our neighbors, the Pokot of Kenya, West Pokot of Kenya, the Turkana of Kenya, the Toposa and the of Southern Sudan, this is where the source of guns are. And because our borders are porous, these guns come through those areas. And that's how the Karamojans have acquired these guns. And there might be also a few within which they might have kept during the disarmament. But the most areas which have actually turned this area into an armed area are the Turkana, the guns coming from Turkana, from Pokot, and from Sudan, including bullets.
Explain to us or update us on the disarmament program that the UPDF has been carrying out there. How is this disarmament program progressing there?
Well, the disarmament program as of now is progressing, but it is not satisfactory because it's not like the one we did in 2006 to 2011. And 2006 to 2011, by 2011, there were no more guns. But now we don't know how this one is being handled. And of course, this one, now, as I have told you, the guns are in the hands of criminal gangs, people who have formed cliques. They know where to hide. They know. So the UPDF is here, tomorrow they are there. So that kind of thing. So it needs now, this disarmament should now be intelligence-led, because we had expected to be intelligence-led disarmament. That's the only way we can get these guns. They are not as many as they used to be, but they are few, but very dangerous. And they are flagging the region into chaos.
Okay. So what do you advise government to do to handle or to improve on what they're already doing in the disarmament program, which you're saying is not satisfactory? You want an intelligence led disarmament,
yes,
exercise. How is this one not intelligence led?
Yeah, because now the issue is, if a thief comes and raids my animals, then the army or the intelligence, the police, everybody who is charged with security, should be able to track for that gun and get that gun out. The problem we have not been getting these guns. The animals are taken, they disappear. Even the gun which came to look for it is not good. So the army should be actually looking for where is this gun which took the cows of Peter Ken or the cows of so and so. If we begin tracing them like that until we get those guns, then we would succeed in this exercise.
Okay. Now, off to your region with all these challenges that you have pointed out, what should government do to bring the region at par with the rest of the country?
Yeah, we need the region, if we want this region actually to come together, we need to address the issues of poverty in the area, being one of the elements which is actually making maybe this policy still and the rest. That one must be addressed. And you can address them, you know, by providing income-generating activities. Then secondly, you can also, you can do it by mechanizing agriculture in Karamoja. Because agriculture, Karamoja is not a barren land. It is actually a fertile land. We don't use even any chemicals. But we have been using that smaller ore we use from those very centuries up to today. How much land can you open with that? So we need the tractors.
Honorable, that ore is also being used elsewhere in the country.
Yes, but where exactly? But at least there should be some accompaniment of some tractors. You cannot use it from the 17th century up to now. You are using that, or you think you'll open more land? The population is growing. We need people to go to commercial agriculture, and you are still using the oil. Because when whatever, like of recent in the other budget, they had given Karamoja over 70 billion to buy tractors, of which tractors were now given everywhere. So that makes us feel that we are being marginalized. Because even what belongs to us is what people can divide among themselves.
But you see, Honorable, you need yourselves as leaders there, and even the people of Karamoja, to come up with initiatives that help you to have a livelihood away from the government's affirmative actions and provision of some of these things you're talking about. How can that be achieved?
Yeah, it cannot be achieved because, first of all, who is supposed to bring law and order in an area of that kind? It is
the government.
It is the government.
Yes.
So if government does not want to bring law and order, what can we do as leaders? For us, we are pro. We are saying let's work together. Some of them, they don't want to work with us. What do we do? Is the question. Mm. So you find them blaming these politicians. For us, we are willing to work with the government. We are willing to work with the army. We are willing to work with everybody, even with the partners in development. But when there is insecurity, how do we really help?
As local leaders, have you done any initiatives to talk to your people and tell them this thieving is aided by us, the community? How don't we find reasons to stop this?
There is no meeting. Even last week, we had just as members of parliament for Nabila Tuka and Napak, we had a very big meeting where we called the division commander and all the security officers, and they attended. And we have been talking about peace, and we have been talking about development, that without peace, there is no development. And indeed, people now in those areas are, there's some kind of peace now. After that meeting, we have been talking to these people here.
Yeah.
Mm. Does not mean that we don't talk, but we talk, but we need support from the rest of the government machineries to help us. Because I can talk as Rochab, but a native of that area. But when you come and talk as Vivian, at least you will also add some value to my what? To my speech.
Okay. So the local leaders there, say the LC5 members in the different districts that form Karamoja sub-region, what is going to be next in the wake of a failed disarmament program, this cattle thieving that is there? What is there for them to do? In the wake of that failed disarmament program, and what we are talking about, these scandals that are going on, what are local leaders like the LC5 members, chairpersons down there, what are they going to do for their people?
Yes, I want you to get me right.
Yeah.
Disarmament is not failing.
Yeah.
But only that somewhere it has been mismanaged. Mm? But it's succeeding, because in some areas, the place is becoming quiet. So it is just the only, what is failing only disarmament is when an incident takes place, it takes long for the security to react. And even when they react, they don't get that gun which came and used that. And you know, when you keep on not recovering the gun which brought a problem to that area, then you are making the problem to multiply. So other people will say, after all, even if you see, they will not follow you up. So for us, we are not, the disarmament is not failing, but it needs us again pulling up our socks and tightening and coming together to make sure that we want to disarm a community which is harmed, so that we see peace in our area.
Then how about the local leadership initiatives down there?
The local leadership is very clear.
Yes, apart from the meetings that you organize to talk to the people, like you just explained.
We also meet as leaders.
Yes.
We have always met as leaders. We have always fought the way forward, but at times, because of what I've already mentioned, we get actually defeated to a certain extent. But we shall not get defeated, because we want that area also to be peaceful like any other area.
Okay. The problem of famine, which is a natural calamity, drought, because the famine is a higher level once it goes past a drought. Mm. And experts say that what we experience there are droughts in Karamoja sub-region. Mm. Now, those issues to do with famine, you have talked about dams that the First Lady helped construct there. How else do you want government to deal with that? Because last year we had a situation where your group at parliament, the MPs from the Karamoja region, asked the public or well-wishers who could come up and help with relief because of the drought. What can be done in preparation for seasons like that?
Yeah, what we needed the government to put infrastructure in place, especially like dams. You can imagine the whole region, we have only about 3 dams which have water. Mm-hmm. So we needed more than that. And of course, I know government has been injecting a lot of funds in those projects. But those who are given the opportunity to do, don't do to the expectation of the people. Like for instance, in my area, there is a dam which costed about 1.2, a valley tank which costed about 1.2 billion shillings. But there is no water. For the last 5 years, there is no water. We have never even seen any drop of water. But they tell you the dam is there, the dam is there. You know, these invisible dams are a problem to us. And of course, the award is always being done at the ministry level. So we, at times, following them, you can't get them. So we are saying government should actually add in water for production. We need water for production. So that even when it's there, people can even at least irrigate some smaller plots of theirs to have some cabbage, some tomatoes around and the rest. But where there's no water, what do you expect? And for us, when the dry season like this one now comes, all, you know, when it rains, Karamoja, we are just in a kind of a tilted, a raised plateau. All the water tend to come down. That's why you hear always the haters are complaining, because our people will say, we are following our water, which rain in April, and we have come only to take this water, and then after this season, we shall go back. So there is a need to harvest water, there is a need actually to have more dams, and there is a need to have more valley tanks in the area if we want actually to curb this insecurity and this movement of people and animals from place to place.
As we end this, Honorable, as an MP who provides oversight for the issues of Karamoja, what do you plan to do? What should your people expect from you in that sense?
Of course, there are people expect from me. They expect a lot. You know, being a member of parliament, people expect a lot. They expect you to bring schools. They expect hospitals. They expect all that.
Have you constructed any schools?
Any schools?
Or hospitals?
It is the work of government. We are telling government, and I'm sure they are constructing some. They are about in this financial year.
Have you sensitized your people about your role?
We have.
Yes.
And they are aware. And whatever they get, they take it as theirs. You know, the problem also has been that there was no ownership in the very beginning. But as of now, whatever goes to them and you explain to them, they will own it. That's why I still refer you to the other dams, which they have never been silted up to now. They still have water because they own it. And they water the animals from a far distance, not directly from the dam. So there's that sense of ownership now. But only that the resources, only that actually, the resources are either scarce or what, and we cannot.
Yes. About your oversight duties.
My oversight role is very clear. Whatever government takes there, it is me to make sure that it's well implemented.
Mm.
And aware that this is just where I am. This is just my first term in parliament. My first time in parliament, and whatever project now goes, we all follow and we make sure that it is actually done to our expectation. All what I've been telling you about what was history of those who were there, but for those of us who are now in parliament, we want to see a change in Karamoja, and we want to see a Karamoja which has also received resources like other areas. And that was why the issue of the iron sheets came first, because we saw we were not going to get these iron sheets at that level of distribution.
Thank you very much, Honorable.
Thank you so much.
That has been the checkpoint this week. We thank you for having followed us this far. And the checkpoint is always here to get deeper analysis of the issues that have come out in the media and check on entities or different MPs who are supposed to be telling us what they are doing as an oversight duty right here at Parliament when they are away from their constituencies. Thank you. Until next week, the checkpoints.